May be seated this morning. Thank you all so much for the gift and the love, and thank you for acknowledging my wife. Thank you guys. She's in the nursery, and she kept reminding me there's communion and they're doing this presentation. We're still going to get out on time, right? We'll be all right. Praise the Lord. I want to thank everybody who worked so hard and volunteered and helped for the Trunk or Treat, our biggest one yet so far. Had a great turnout of people, great event. It was just awesome, and I want to thank everyone who helped with that. Praise the Lord. Open your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5 is going to be our text for this week and next week as we look at the roles and the responsibilities of the husband and the wife. Now, since we are short on time today, we'll look at the husbands today, and then next week when we've got an hour and a half, we'll look at the... I'm a big talker when my wife's not in here, right? I'm a big talker. Hey, I need Andrew and Heidi to come up here. Is Heidi in here? Where is she? Oh, okay. Well, when she comes back in here, I need you guys up there. Andrew's like, oh, no. Hey, in a review, while we wait for Heidi to come in here, because I can't really kick off the lesson until I use them for this thing. Let's get a quick review. Last week, as we started looking at marriage, we looked at Genesis chapter 1 and 2, and we saw that God is a creator, not an inventor. An inventor invents something and sits back and just lets it go, right? But a creator is involved, intimately involved with their creation. Hey, Tim and Kate are here. I'll have them come up since they're out. Come up here, Tim and Kate. Come here. No. You guys wait for me right there. You're up next. For a successful marriage, every marriage needs two things: the grace of God and rock 'em sock 'em robots. Right? Calm down, Tim. Tim, you come on this side. We're going to have the first round: men versus women, husbands versus wives. Wait. Okay, they're set. That's a veteran right there, man. That's a veteran of marriage right there. How many are voting for Kate? How many are voting for Tim? Well, this is going to be good. This is going to be good. All right. In position on three. One, two, three, go. One for the men. Hold on, I got a participation prize for you guys to continue. No, it's not broken. To continue with the family fun, for you to participate, and I do not get paid for endorsing this. Bean Boozled, this is the funnest, most awful game that you could ever take part in your life. It's guaranteed to bring your marriage together and your children happy. All right, Andrew and Heidi, you're up next. Wow.
She knows that our kids go play with this over in the office. They know that the blue one is the one that's the good one.
All right, fellas. Who's rooting for Andrew? Are we going to go for 2-0? How about for Heidi? All right.
I got my fill in for Clay. See how long you guys are here. Whoa.
All right. To save your marriage. Whoa. Easy, cowboy. On three. One, two, three. Fuck. Man, that didn't take long. Andrew didn't put up much of a fight there. Also, Bean Boozled for you. Your kids will love that. Thank you guys for playing. Well, that was fun, and it truly is the best way to handle a relationship problem as a Christian. The neighbors think you're having a good time. They don't call the cops, you know, and no drywall gets busted and that kind of stuff like that. But there are, God has made roles and rules, and He has put this whole thing in order. And we saw last week in the creation that God is a creator and He is involved with His creation. We saw that He specifically made man, He specifically made woman, He specifically made marriage, and He's got a purpose and a place and a role, and they work together, right? God, we saw three things from that study. The first thing we saw is that God is a God of order. He's not a God of confusion, right? The definition of order is this: a proper arrangement of people, things, or ideas for the purpose of a particular operation or effective use. That's the definition of order. God is a God of order. The definition of chaos or disorder is the confused, unorganized state of things, right? God is a God of order. Our universe, our planet, this whole solar system works with such precision that the greatest minds on the planet haven't figured out how this thing works. Now, they've gotten some clues into it and stuff like that, but they still haven't figured out how God does all this stuff. Their biggest problem is they don't consider God in it, right? They think we're just space trash that bumped into each other, and that's a whole other set of teachings. The second thing we saw from Genesis 1 and 2 is that God can make something beautiful and wonderful out of darkness and chaos. Remember what the Bible said, that the earth was without form and void, right? And darkness was on the face of the deep. And God, through His Word, spoke His Word, and He brought beauty out of this, and He created our world. Friends, a lot of people's marriage is like Genesis 1, 2, you know, void and darkness on the face of the deep. You ask somebody, are you happily married? Oh, yeah. Well, we can speak the Word into that situation, right? And God can make something beautiful out of it. The third thing we learn, most important thing, this is usually the hardest lesson for us to learn, is that God is a lot smarter than man. The greatest example of that is with the boats. Let me tell you about the two boats. The greatest minds on the planet put together, designed, and built this ship called the Titanic. This massive ship, the greatest achievement that man, they had engineers, they had oceanographers, weather, they had all these people that were the top of the field in the world come together, build this ship that they said no one can sink. And it's resting at the bottom of the ocean. It brought death, disaster, and destruction, right? Now compare it to a simple farmer by the name of Noah, who just very simply followed God's word, God's direction, and he built this ark. Now the Titanic is sitting and resting on the bottom of the ocean. Guess where the ark is sitting? It's on top of a mountain, right? The Titanic brought death and disaster. The ark preserved life and brought blessing, right? So friends, if we would just follow the direction in the Word of God, you might be navigating on the dark, icy seas like the Titanic in your marriage. But God's Word can get you through it, right? Praise the Lord. So with that, we get into our text, Ephesians chapter 5. We're going to look at the fellas' roles today. Now, in Ephesians chapter 5, we've got probably the most used, the most studied portion of Scripture that deals with husbands and wives and with their roles and their responsibility. But the whole emphasis of this passage is usually misplaced. Because, see, we read this passage in the essence of the subordination of a wife to her husband. We take out the single phrase, the husband is the head of the wife, and we quote that in isolation without looking at the entire passage. See, the basis of this passage in Ephesians 5 is not the issue of control, it's the issue of love. Right? The issue of love. So let's begin reading. Are you there? Ephesians 5. Let's begin reading at verse 23. Fellas like verse 22. Most people memorize John 3:16. Men memorize Ephesians 5:22. We'll get to that next week. Look at verse 23. For the husband is the head of the wife, as also Christ is the head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body. Drop down to verse 32. We talked about this last week. This is the key to this whole thing. This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. When God made marriage, he made male, he made female. When he put them together, it's a picture of Jesus Christ's relationship with the church, with us. And how many of you know that Jesus is supposed to be the head of the church? Right? And humans are made to exemplify that. So it says in verse 23, for the husband is the head of the wife. Now, for the overhead, please, Daryl, would you put 1 Timothy 2:13 and 14? This tells us why God chose to do it this way. For Adam was formed first. We read that in the Genesis account. And then Eve. And Adam was not deceived, but the woman being deceived fell into transgression. The reason God has put the order in the way he has is not because men are smarter than women. Ladies, you know that, right? But simply because that's the order of creation. The only reason. Now, turn with me. Keep your place in Ephesians 5. That's our text. But go back to Genesis chapter 3 real quick. And there I'm going to ask you to put that word on the board here. Any guesses how to pronounce that word? You guys did about as good as me. That is the English spelling of the Hebrew word that is translated desire here in Genesis 3:16. Let's look at this. Genesis 3, verse 16. This is all because of the curse, right? This whole curse, this whole sin thing. Look at Genesis 3:16. To the woman, to Eve, God is speaking, and he said, I will greatly multiply your sorrow and your conception. In pain you shall bring forth children. Isn't it interesting how in the animal kingdom, the animals give birth, and it hardly slows them down, right? They just keep going. But for the human female, it's a much more difficult process and procedure, right? Well, that's because of the curse. Now, notice this here. God says, your desire, that word desire is that word there. I can't pronounce it. But what it means, here's the definition of what this word means. It means to an attempt to usurp or to control. God says, as part of this curse, your desire shall be for your husband, and he shall rule over you. Now, we read that, your desire shall be for your husbands, and us guys think, yeah, because I'm a hot dude, man. She's all over me, right? She's all about me. That's not what it says. I've got some things twirling right here. As part of the curse, breaking up the order that God has made, part of that, the effects of the curse is now the woman shall try to move herself out of her God-given position and role and try to rule over the man. Hey, y'all know we're voting this week? Don't forget to vote. Now, you're still in Genesis? Genesis chapter 4, verse 7. Check how this works. Same word used in 4:7. God and Cain are having a little discussion because Cain's throwing a fit and not happy and all this kind of stuff. In verse 7, God says, if you do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, notice this, sin lies at the door and it's, what's that word? His desire is for you. That's the same word. Friends, sin wants to control you. It wants to pounce on you. It wants to put you under its control and to drive you to destruction, right? That's the same word. You see how it's used? But he tells Cain here, but you shall rule over it. Friends, how many of you know that struggling with sin can be a struggle? But God has given us the ability to be able to control that, right? So, let's go back to Ephesians 5. How many of you have heard of Dr. Lewis Talbot? Dr. Lewis Talbot was a preacher in the 40s, and he was a little bitty guy, wasn't even quite 5 foot tall, but man, this guy could preach. And one day, he's in Chicago, and he's preaching on the roles and responsibilities of the husband and wife, and this gal got so mad at him that afterwards she came up to him and she says, "Dr. Talbot, if I was your wife, I would poison your tea." And he said, "Ma'am, if you were my wife, I'd drink it." Isn't that funny? Ephesians 5:25. We're going to look at the husband. The husbands have got one command. Obey us. Husbands, love your wives. But don't stop there. Just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her. Go ahead and circle that word love there, and right next to it, agape. Agape, A-G-A-P-A. This is not eros love. You don't have to tell a man to have erotic love, right? But we do have to instruct a man to have God's kind of love. This agape love is the perfect love. It's the ultimate love. Agape love, God's love, gives. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, right? Eros love, the erotic love, is a taker, right? It's about getting, not about giving. And here he's talking to the men, and us husbands, we're told to love, to agape our wives as God loved the church and gave himself for it. Well, how did God love the church? Well, I've got this broken down into a few things. We're going to look at it, and we're going to kind of speed through it because we are running late, but this is very important. I think you guys will be glad we took the time. The first kind of love that husbands were to have for our wives, and if you're not married, you may be someday, so fellas, pay attention. Ladies, you too. But it's to be a sacrificial love, not a selfish love. He gave himself for the church. Agape means giving. Now, this includes giving honor. For the overhead, would you put 1 Peter 3:7? Check this out. In the epistle Peter wrote, he addresses husbands and wives, and here he says, "Husbands, likewise, dwell with them." The "them" there is the wife in this whole thing. "Dwell with them with understanding." Notice this. Giving honor to the wife. Giving honor. Friends, I'm just going to be truthful and straight up during these teachings. You guys okay with that? Fellas, one of our biggest problems is when we're at the wedding and when we put on the rings and our wife says, "I do," we say, "I'm done." Right? We need to continue to honor our brides and to treat them in our married days like we did in our courting days. Right? So we're to give honor. It says, "as unto the weaker vessel." Now, that doesn't mean a woman is lower than us. Some people argue, no, it means it's talking about physical strength. It's not even talking about physical strength. What it's talking about here is as a beautifully crafted vessel, you would treat differently and with more respect than a big bulky thing. Let me just give you an example here. A teacup, you got an antique teacup made of porcelain, right? You take very good care of it, right? You're soft with it, you're tender with it. Do you know that the porcelain that made that teacup, they also make toilets with? So fellas, our wives are the teacups. Never mind, you get the... We're to treat our brides like something special and tender and valuable. Doesn't that make sense? Now, it says, with understanding. Guys, you understand your woman? Ladies, there are two times we do not understand you. Before we were married, and after we were married. Sigmund Freud, the father of modern day psychology, after he did a 35-year research on women, and he came up at the end of this 35 years, he said, I only have one question. What do you want? Tell me what you want. Because ladies, if you haven't figured it out yet, we're dumb. It's not that we don't care. We just don't know. We just don't know. Here's how dumb men are. And you guys can probably relate to this. Ladies, when we say to you, what's wrong? And you say, nothing. We don't think nothing's wrong. No need to talk about it, nothing's wrong, right? And when you ladies ask us men, hey, where would you like to go eat? And we say, oh, I don't care, anywhere. That means we'll go anywhere. So when we turn around and say to you, hey, baby, where you want to eat? And you say, oh, I don't care, anywhere. And we go, oh, good, Olive Garden. You go, ew, no, no, no. Well, now we're confused, right? We're confused. We don't. And ladies, this will be a little embarrassing because my mom's in here, but I'm going to just say it. You confuse us in the bedroom sometimes too. Because some days we swear you've been drinking. The Buckeye people. And so we're feeling pretty confident, right? And here's how a man thinks. So we think, well, I'll try that again. And we find out the next day you've been working in the ice plant, right? We're confused. We don't understand you. So give us a little grace, right? Help us out a little bit. It is true. The next way that we are to love our wives, next point of the sacrificial love, we're back in Ephesians 5, is it's to be a sacrificial love. Notice in verse 25 it says, he gave himself for her. He died for her. This means, friends, that, fellas, let me ask you this. If some big, mean, scary dude breaks into your house and his goal, his attempt is to do your wife harm, to injure her, to hurt her, to kill her, it means, are you willing to take a bullet for her? I asked that in a men's group once. I said, fellas, are you willing to take a bullet for your woman? And one guy says, I'd take a bullet for my woman, not in the chest. Or maybe the foot. Yeah. What's the caliber? I'm like, Dad, come on now. But that's what that means. He gave himself for her. We're to be our wife's defender. So, fellas, let me ask you this, not joking. You know, would you be willing to stop that guy that's wanting to hurt your wife? Would you be willing to kill that guy who's trying to kill your wife? I got a yeah from all the men. Now, what if that man is you? Because, fella, every time you browbeat your wife, you're slowly killing that creature that God has made. Fella, when you're always complimenting some other lady, co-worker, or somewhere else, but you're constantly criticizing your wife, you're tightening the noose that's around her neck. And, mister, if you're physically hurting her. Number one, you're not a man. Or if you're emotionally or sexually abusing her, you've got a problem. And you might as well be putting a gun to her head, because you're killing the greatest creation that God ever made. Now, I don't read your mail. I don't spy in your windows. And I certainly hope that none of this applies to anybody in here. But if it does, you need to stop. You need to repent before God, before your wife. And God will set you free. The husband is the head of the wife. Paul did say that. But he also said that the husband must love his wife as Christ loved the church. with a love which never exercises a tyranny of control, but with love which is ready to make any sacrifice for her good. I got thinking about this week as I was reviewing it in my mind. And you know, if the husband, in the husband-wife role, if the husband is playing the Jesus role in the way all this is set up, how would you act if Jesus treated you the way you treat your wife? Would you stick around? Something to think about, right? The next way we are to love our wives. First one was protector. The second one is materially. Materially. For the overhead, 1 Timothy 5:8. If anyone does not provide for his own, and especially those of his household, he is denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. Husbands, we're not only to be our wives' protectors, but we're also to be her provider. The husband is to provide for our wives' domestic needs. Fellas, don't put your wife on some unrealistic budget and expect her to multiply it like Jesus did the loaves and fishes. Yeah, don't give her a tuna fish budget and demand lobster from her. You know what I'm saying? The next way we're to love our wives, the third way, we're back in Ephesians 5, verse 26 and 27. It must be a purifying love. Purifying love. Let's look at verse 26 and 27. That he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of the water by the word, that he might present her to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she would be holy and without blemish. Husbands, we have the spiritual responsibility for our wives. We are to be the spiritual leader. Now, I know, we all know in here that there are some dynamics that changes that up a little bit, right? But the role that God has made for the husband is he is to be the spiritual head of the household as part of our roles and responsibilities. I often say, and I mean this, fellas, do all that you can to enable and to allow and encourage your wife to be involved in her own spiritual growth. You see, the greatest investment anyone can make in their own family for their own marriage is the spiritual growth of their spouse or their children, right? Fellas, do what you can to make sure your wife gets involved in the women's ministry or activities of the church. Vice versa. Ladies, do what you can to encourage your men to get involved in the men's thing and the stuff in the church, right? I mean, let's invest in our spiritual lives. Remember the pyramid with God on top and us on the, right? Okay, as we're trucking towards God, we're getting closer together. Amen? The fourth way that we are to love our wives is it must be a caring love, caring love. Look at verse 28 and 29. 28 and 29 says, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. For no one has ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as the Lord does the church. A man must love his wife like he loves his own body and cares for it. Right? We take care of what we love. Real love always cherishes what it loves. That word cherish means to esteem or to value. What you value, you take care of, right? And friends, if you're spending more time, attention, and money on your car or hobby than you do your wife, you need to reevaluate your priorities here. Right? Not many amens on that one. Our wives are not our maids or our servants. They are our spiritual partners to be cherished. The fifth way we are to love our wives, still found in our text here, is it's to be an unbroken love. Look at verse 31, an unbroken love. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. To separate from each other would be the equivalent of ripping off two of your own limbs. People just don't do that, right? That word cleave, they shall be joined together. The old King James says, they shall cleave. That means a gluing, an infusing of two to make one. I got a great example here. I've got two pieces of paper, this colored and white, and I glued them together. So it kind of bleeding through here. But I glued these two pieces of paper together because this is a great example of marriage. Now, it's kind of funny. The wife's side, it's nice and smooth, and the man's side is wrinkly. My man. Jeez. But here's what divorce does. The two have become one, right? So to try to separate them, look what's happening. I can't even. That's a strong marriage, only one corner. See what's happening here? Destroying both papers. Oops. The funnest part of this is watching Kate and Norma go, "My vacuum." Isn't this a good example? That's what marriage does. I mean, divorce does marriage. That was not a Freudian slip. But you guys, you get it, right? Right? I'm going to pick it up, Norma. Do you know why second marriages have even a greater divorce rate than first-time marriages? Because you're putting things like this together to try to make one. You're taking two broken people to try to make something. Right? Now, it gets better. The next way we're to love our wives, all right, fellas, if you're taking notes, here's the way. We're to love our wives sexually. They become one flesh. For the overhead, please. Hebrews 13:4. Marriage is honorable among all, and the bed, the marriage bed, undefiled. Friends, I don't know if you've heard this from a preacher before, but God has given us sex to enjoy our spouse, not just for procreation, but also to enjoy each other. We come together. That's why the marriage bed is undefiled. You go outside of the marriage bed, horsing around and doing stuff we shouldn't, it turns into something bad. Fornication, adultery, and God judges that, right? Right? But we, as married people, are to enjoy each other physically. For the overhead, 1 Corinthians 7:3-5. It's kind of interesting. Paul is talking to the Corinthian church, and he says, "Let the husband render to his wife the affection due to her, and likewise also the wife to her husband." He's talking about the sexual life of a married couple. The wife doesn't have authority over her own body, but the husband does. Now, most husbands like to stop there. Can I get a grunt from the men? But it goes on. "And likewise, the husband doesn't have authority over his own body, but the wife does. Do not deprive one another," talking about coming together sexually, "don't deprive one another except with consent for a time, that you may give yourselves to fasting and prayer and come together again, so that Satan does not tempt you because of your lack of self-control." Ladies, the number one reason that men give for having an affair is an unsatisfied sex life at home. Number one reason that they give for doing that. You know what the number one reason that a wife gives for having an affair? Not having the emotional support that she requires. This brings us to the next thing on our list here. We're not only to love our wives sexually, but also emotionally. Still in verse 35 here, it says that you will leave your father and your mother. See, as children, we get our emotional support, our emotional guidance, our bringing up from our mothers and our fathers, right? When we go into a marriage, that now transfers to our spouse. Let me give you some stern warning here. Brothers and sisters, be careful that you do not get your emotional support from somebody other than your spouse. Office friendships will soon start crossing the line. And when you're sharing personal information and details with someone other than your spouse, you're opening yourself up for trouble. Now, fellas, let me talk to you. We tend to want to shut that kind of communication down. We talked about communication last week, okay? If your wife wants to talk, you guys need to talk. Remember years ago when you were courting, you guys could talk all night? Now you can't think of nothing to say after what's for dinner. Pass the salt, maybe, you know, right? We're to love our spouses emotionally. Notice also, ladies, I want to kind of direct this to you. Notice that it says he will leave his father and mother. Beware of a man who never grows up. He'd be 30 years old and still be a boy. And all you're doing is getting yourself set up for some problems in a marriage if you marry a boy, right? So, moms and dads, don't let that happen. Well, I've got a whole list of other things. We're going to turn to 1 Corinthians 13, the love chapter, and begin looking to see if we're fulfilling all those love things towards our wife. But because of time, we'll just stop right there and pick it up next week. That sound good? All right. Let's stand and let's pray. Worship team, join me up here. We certainly want to acknowledge God and His goodness in our lives. We want to acknowledge God and His goodness in our spouses and our marriages. We certainly don't want to embarrass anybody or ruffle any feathers, but please know that I'm here, we're here as a church to support in any way that we can. And so what I'm going to do is, instead of just going on and on and on before we open the altars, I'm just going to say a prayer for concluding our study. Then we're going to open the altars, and if God has spoken to your heart, maybe your marriage needs prayer. Maybe your marriage doesn't, but maybe you need a touch in your body, you're ailing, or maybe there's a financial need or crisis. It could be anything. Friends, please understand this and know this and realize this, that the altar is not a place of embarrassment. Okay? It is not a place of condemnation. There's nothing wrong with coming to the altar of God. That's where people need to be, right? No one is judging you. A lot of people feel they're being judged. That is not the purpose of an altar. The purpose of an altar is to get things right with God and let God do some healing and some work, right? So please don't let fear or intimidation stop you if you need to come pray. Fellows are going to join me up here, and it will be open for prayer afterwards. So let's pray right now, shall we? Father in heaven, thank you so much, Lord, for this church, Lord, that we can come together and worship and praise you. We can celebrate communion. And Father, we can study your word. Lord, marriages are under such attack these days. Lord, we understand why, because the enemy wants to ruin the picture that you have painted of your love for us. And the enemy wants to destroy that, and he's doing a good job. So, Father, today I pray that you'd speak to all of our hearts. And, Lord, I pray that today you'd bring forgiveness and healing and restoration if that is needed. Lord, I pray and I pronounce a blessing over every marriage that is represented here today. Lord, I pray that you would break down any walls that need to be broken down in any marriages. I pray that you would break any chains that need to be broken. Lord, I release in the name of Jesus your peace, your love, and your mercy upon every marriage that is here today, Lord God. Father, we acknowledge, Father, the greatest gift that you have given to us is the gift of our spouse. And so today, Lord, we pray for our spouses. Help us to be a better spouse. Help us to be the husband or the wife that you've called us to be. And Lord, I want to pray for those here today who may be single. Lord, I pray that today they would not be discouraged, but encouraged, knowing, Lord, that you have someone special for them. They just need to be patient and keep their focus and attention on you. Lord, there may be some here today who have gone through divorce, Lord, would you reassure them that is not the unforgivable sin, and that you've got a great plan of restoration for them. Lord, whatever the needs would be, we trust you today to meet those needs. And we give you the praise and the glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's worship God.